I think we'll go ahead and get started here. You guys can hear me okay? So today we're going to talk about panniculitis. And a lot of people sort of, when they think of panniculitis, they get worried and they think it's hard and it's difficult to diagnose and this, that, and the other. And it's really not that difficult. The key to it is getting a good biopsy. So when you're taking a biopsy of panniculitis, you need to, if you're going to use a scalpel, it needs to be at 90 degrees to the skin. It can't be a shave type of biopsy. If you even think about doing that, you're not going to get enough sample. That's number one. And number two, even a punch biopsy like this one that you see here, it's sitting on its side. I'll move it over in a minute. Has to be deep. You can't just take your punch and put it down to the where the metal meets the plastic. Sometimes you have to actually take the plastic and push it all the way down into the skin. I mean, you really have to go deep. And it's sometimes tough to get a punch biopsy that goes deep enough. You know, this, look how deep this is. I mean, this is, you know, most punches usually kind of go about this deep. So whoever did this must have been working out. I mean, they really pushed very hard and they got way down into the deep part of the fat. And that's what you really need for a biopsy of a punch biopsy of panniculitis. In some cases, you probably just need to bite the bullet and do an incisional biopsy of panniculitis. Because if there's several things that can go wrong. Even if you do a punch, it's deep enough. If the fat is degenerated, you may pull out your punch and you think you've got a nice specimen, but most of the fat is sitting down at the bottom of the punch because it's all degenerated and it's just turns into goo. And there's nothing there. So you think you've got a good specimen and maybe you only have a little bit of fat that makes it into the biopsy bottle. Another thing that you need to do in some of these panniculitis is you need to see if there's vasculitis. And so if you take a punch, it's sort of like shooting an arrow and you don't know where it's going to land. I mean, you may hit a blood vessel, you may not. And so if you need to, you know, have a diagnosis of panniculitis with vasculitis, if you don't have a blood vessel, your punch may miss it. So if you take a larger incisional biopsy, the chances you're going to actually get a blood vessel is higher. And if you don't feel comfortable doing that, especially if it's somebody that, you know, maybe he's got a complicated case, you know, maybe they might have nodular vasculitis, or maybe they may have PAN or something like that. And you really need to get a blood vessel and you don't feel comfortable doing it, or maybe your clinic's too busy and you don't really have time to set it up or whatever, then send it to a surgeon and then say, hey, I need a deep incisional biopsy of this to make a diagnosis. So just realize that half the battle in panniculitis is getting the biopsy proper, getting a good enough sample. So today we're going to go through, I got 11 different examples of things. I'm looking at these for the first time, just like you are, by the way. I didn't pre-screen these. So this is just like we're sitting at the microscope, something pops across the stage, but instead of it's melanoma, one specimen, the next specimen is a panniculitis. We're looking at all of them are panniculitis, but I'm going to treat it just the same way you are. And in order to go through these, which I'm going to do just like you are, is you have to have a algorithmic approach, just like everything else we've talked about. So we've talked about the 9 different patterns of inflammatory skin disease. Well, now we're talking about the 9th pattern, which is panniculitis. And when you, if you use the criteria, and if the specimen actually is demonstrating the features, it's really not that hard to make a pretty definitive diagnosis of panniculitis. Obviously, you always like to have clinical correlation, but if you use the criteria, and if the specimen is good, and the specimen is taken in at a stage in which panniculitis is demonstrating its classic features, you can make a diagnosis most of the time. It's easier than superficial perivascular dermatitis, for example, which you have lots of things that cause it, or, you know, 10 different things called spongiotic dermatitis. You really have to have clinical correlation there. So the main things we look for is first of all, whether it's septal mostly, lobular mostly, and then I say mostly because there's usually a mixture of those two. It's not usually perfectly 100% septal. It's not usually 100% lobular. There's usually a mix. But if you say it's mostly one or the other. That's very helpful. And then we ask ourselves whether there's vasculitis or not. So that's the second thing we look for. And then we look for the type of inflammation that's present. If you get all those things together and you like apply those criteria, and again, notice there's really not that many branches to the tree. It's only a few. You can usually make a definitive diagnosis. And one other thing we look for is whether there's overlying dermal inflammation. So let's take a look at this one. So this is the most common form of panniculitis that we could biopsy, I would say, when it's really a true primary inflammatory panniculitis that we're looking for, not a secondary panniculitis. And that's the other thing to think about too. Is it really primary panniculitis or is it secondary panniculitis? So let's say you have a ruptured cyst or something and it ruptures down into the fat, you know, or like an infection or something like that. Well, that's secondary panniculitis. So that's sort of cheating, if you will. It's not really true primary panniculitis. But here we're looking at a primary panniculitis. So the pathology is down here in the fat primarily. It's not up in the dermis. Scroll this back a little bit. I was trying to move it up a little bit to show you that. So if you look at the dermis here, notice that it's pretty much not involved very much. Okay, there's a little bit of inflammation up here, but it's minimal. This isn't where the action is. The action is going on down here in the fat. And in panniculitis, you definitely want to spend a little time at low power. You don't want to just jump to high power because you want to decide what the pattern is. So notice it's septal mostly. Most of this inflammation is affecting the septa. And normally, if you look at a normal biopsy, somebody's fat, the septa are so thin, you can't really see them at low magnification. It really looks like just fat with little teensy tiny strands of collagen running between them with some blood vessels. So when you see the septa that are markedly thickened like this, it's 1,000 times thicker than normal, you say, wow, this is abnormal. So it's septal panniculitis. And notice that there's some lobular involvement around the septa, but it's really zooming in mostly on the septa. So septal mostly panniculitis. Now, is there vasculitis? Well, we don't really see any obvious vasculitis. I mean, maybe there's some little blood vessels here that are possibly involved, but we don't really see any large blood vessels, you know, that are present down in the subcutaneous fat. Most of the blood vessels down there are a little bit larger. They're not the real large blood vessels like you see in somebody's body cavity, but they're relatively large compared to the venules and the arterioles and whatnot that overlie that in the dermis. So if you don't see any of those larger blood vessels that are inflamed with fibrin and lots of inflammation in there, there's no vasculitis. Now that could be because we haven't sampled the blood vessel here, but at least in this specimen, septal mostly, no vasculitis. Now, what kind of inflammation is present? That's the next step. So we go to higher magnification and we've got granulomatous inflammation. We've got histiocytes. We've got lymphocytes. We've got some neutrophils. And sometimes in this specific panniculitis, if it's kind of early, you may not see a lot of granulomatous inflammation yet, but you may actually get a few histiocytes, and then you can get some eosinophils when you get an early lesion of this condition. And this is actually a classic example of erythema nodosa. It's the most common form of classic true panniculitis that we get biopsy. So again, we get lots of other biopsies of other kinds of panniculitis, secondary panniculitis from ruptured cysts and things like that. But the most classic panniculitis that people biopsy is this, I would say. So erythema nodosa. And you all know what that looks like clinically. Obviously the brown, red nodules on the pretibial surfaces, painful. You want to rule out diseases that are associated with it. So it can be seen in association with deep fungal infection, with strep, with sarcoids. So it can be seen with a lot of different conditions. So make sure that you know the various diseases that are associated with erythema nodosa. If I were writing a board question, I probably would show something like this and say this entity can be associated with which of the following diseases. Expect you to know those. So classic erythema nodosa, beautiful example of it. And notice the very nice biopsy that was taken here. Okay, another example, classic, beautiful example of this entity. Both of the two specimens show it, so we'll just focus on one. So we have a punch biopsy. Probably a 6-millimeter punch. This is a good, nice, deep punch biopsy. Went all the way down to the subcutaneous fat. So they didn't get quite as deep as the last one, but they still got lots of fat in the specimen. So that's good. They did a good job here. Gave us a good specimen. Didn't take a shave biopsy or a superficial narrow punch biopsy. And notice here, in contrast to the last one, we don't have the septa that seemed to be involved mostly. We got mostly the lobules. So in contrast to the last one, we've got lobular mostly panniculitis. Now, whenever you get the lobules involved, usually the septa kind of get involved secondarily. So when you think about an inflammatory response, it's kind of hitting all of the fat. It's going to probably hit the septa some too, but this is mostly lobular here. Okay. So again, lobular panniculitis with vasculitis or without vasculitis. I don't see any vasculitis here. Then we ask ourselves what kind of inflammation is present in here. And in low magnification, you see that these are dark cells. So most of these are going to be lymphocytes. There may be some plasma cells in here. And then you ask yourself, well, is there anything ancillary here, anything else that's present in the specimen that might be helpful? So when you see lobular, mostly panniculitis, you should ask yourself, what's the status of the fat cells themselves? What's going on with them? And if they develop sort of a pink hyaline characteristic like you see here, that's very, very suggestive, very characteristic of lupus erythematosus panniculitis, lupus profundus, lupus panniculitis. So lobular mostly, as opposed to septal, with lymphocytes and often plasma cells, and the fat starts becoming degenerated, and it gets this hyaline degeneration here. And eventually, basically just kind of get a hyaline proliferation like you see over here, that's replacing almost all of the fat, and the inflammation may kind of gradually kind of go to zero. You may just see mostly this burned out hyalinized fat. And I think we had an unknown a few weeks ago that showed the clinical features of LE profundus, and it's the most common panniculitis in the upper part of the body. So panniculitis in the arms, face, it looks, if you see that clinically, you should think it, you know, number one, maybe it's lupus panniculitis. And the other thing is lupus panniculitis associated with systemic LE in a pretty high percentage of cases, 60% of cases that have this are going to have systemic manifestations. So it's not usually seen with just pure cutaneous lupus. And they very commonly get plasma cells to infiltrate. So anytime you get kind of sclerosis in the specimen, we've talked about that before, generally plasma cells develop. And the other thing we talk about with lupus, as opposed to erythema nodosum, it's very common to get overlying features of lupus in the dermis. So here we've got a lymphocytic infiltrate, lymphoplasmacytic infiltrate in the dermis. And also, if you look at the DE junction in LE panniculitis, I don't know that it's present in this specimen, but it's very common to see some changes at the DE junction with some evidence of overlying vacuolar alteration, thickening of the base membrane zone. Not as prevalent in this specimen here, but it's pretty common. So if you're looking for LE panniculitis, and then there's a differential we'll talk about a little bit later on, the subcutaneous panniculitis like T-cell lymphoma, that can sometimes simulate LE panniculitis. If you look at the overlying dermis and epidermis and you see features of lupus, then that strongly favors lupus panniculitis over the rare example when you see the lymphoma that can simulate lupus. So beautiful example of that as well. Okay, let's look at the next one. Okay, and this one again, notice not taken quite as well here, but it's pretty deep. And what probably happened here is that this fat was so degenerated, they tried to pull it out and they didn't really get much. So they kind of had to go in and kind of snip at the bottom of it and see what they could kind of get out of it. But this was probably a situation where the fat was degenerated and it was kind of turning into a white, chalky, milky substance. And sometimes when you get fat that gets degenerated, like in patients, say, with vasculitis, with, say, nodular vasculitis, whatever, that fat turns into kind of an oily material. When you slice into it, kind of an oily material will come out of there. In some cases, if it calcifies, it's more white and calcific and looks like chalk coming out of it. So here we've got some degeneration of the fat here. We've got some fibrosis, some inflammation, pretty nonspecific when you just look at this. Okay, so this is just kind of a chronic inflammation, lower dermis and the subcutaneous fat. And then you look over here and you start getting a clue as to what might be going on. There's calcium. So calcium here. So there's a little bit of fat here. Looks like it's in the lobules mostly. There's this inflammation, there's calcification, and then the real action is down here in this little bit of fat that didn't come out with a punch that they had to go down here and kind of probably snip to kind of dig this out. It was probably remaining at the bottom of the punch. And you see this classic pathognomonic morphology of what we call saponification of the fat. And this is where the fat has turned into soap in the skin. And why does it do that? Because there is circulating amylase and lipase that is going in and it's reacting with the fat, it's breaking it down. Then the host undergoes this very classic dystrophic calcification of the individual lipocytes here, the fat microcysts, and it gives you this ghost-like appearance. It looks almost like plant material. So if you look at a splinter, for example, you see the little cells, the little xylem and phloem of a plant stem or of a leaf or a splinter, whatever it is. This looks a lot like that, except it's got calcium in there, but it's not plant material at all. This is actually an enzymatic calcification, saponification of the fat, and it's pathognomonic of some type of pancreatitis or sialadenitis or something like that. Usually, the vast majority of cases is due to pancreas. If you kind of get inflammation of your salivary glands, the same kind of tissue, it generally takes more enzymes circulating throughout your body to produce a panniculitis than it generates if you have a sialadenitis. Usually this is pancreas, 99% of the time. In fact, we usually call it pancreatic panniculitis when you see this. But the interesting thing about it is, it's not actually a true inflammatory panniculitis. What it is an enzymatic chemical reaction of the subcutaneous fat that then produces secondary inflammation. So this stuff here is all secondary. So just imagine if you took a little piece of soap and injected it into your skin, it would produce a lot of inflammatory reaction like you see here. So this is basically a in vivo foreign body reaction. If your body is developing something that's foreign to it, getting a secondary inflammatory reaction, and then you get the panniculitis occurring secondary to that. And it's very common in these cases to get transepidermal elimination of this stuff. The body recognizes that it's foreign material and then starts transepidermally eliminating it. And then you get this white chalky material that gets extruded through the epidermis. So this is pancreatic panniculitis. Now there's a few other enzymatic panniculitides that can give you inflammation secondary to that. Probably the most common is alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency panniculitis. And there you get the alpha-1 antitrypsin that goes in and dissolves the fat. And if you get that in a real early stage, it really almost looks like the fat, someone just took scissors and just kind of snipped it away. And you get the separation of individual lobules from one another. And then soon after that, you get a striking amount of inflammation. And instead of getting the saponification, you get neutrophils that come in. And it's a horrible panniculitis. It's a massive neutrophilic panniculitis. It just burns up all the fat and just basically turns it into a soup of neutrophils. So that's alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency panniculitis. Okay, this one is nice. Here we've got a large blood vessel that is involved in the deep subcutaneous fat. And we just have one piece to look at this time. But we notice that we've got this inflammation affecting this blood vessel. And there's also abundant lobular panniculitis. Now, whenever you get a larger blood vessel involved, so like this, you don't really have to have fibrin and thrombosis of the lumen of the blood vessel for it to mean that it's truly inflamed. So if you get a larger blood vessel, it can be inflamed on two things. It can be secondary to inflammation occurring elsewhere, or it can be primary. But if you get a small blood vessel, it gets some inflammation in and out of the blood vessel walls. That doesn't necessarily mean it's vasculitis. But if you get a larger blood vessel that's got inflammation in the wall, it does mean that it's vasculitis. So here, we've got some of that. We've got some inflammation in the wall of the blood vessel here. Got some inflammation inside the lumen of the blood vessel here. We don't have any fibrin, but we just have some inflammation in here. Here's another blood vessel that's kind of off to the side of it. So this is the blood vessel that's kind of being, it's circulating. And over here, there's a lot more inflammation in this blood vessel. So we've got vasculitis, and here there may even be some fibrin possibly, but we've definitely got larger blood vessel vasculitis, true vasculitis here, with panniculitis, with suppuration and degeneration of the fat, and with some granulomatous inflammation here, with some histiocytes. So this, again, so we got vasculitis and lobular panniculitis, 2 + 2 = 4, with suppurative granulomatous inflammation, nodular vasculitis, erythema indurata, not erythema nodosum. So when you see this, beautiful example of it here. We don't get this very much because it's really relatively rare to get a beautiful biopsy like this that actually samples the blood vessel, and it's also got the suppuration and granulomatous inflammation in the lobules. When you see this, it's just, it's fantastic, and it's perfect, and this is exactly what you want to see. And once again, this is associated with other underlying diseases. So the classic one is tuberculosis. Now, this isn't actually got TB in it. If you do, fight stains on this, usually you don't find any organisms. In fact, almost never find any organisms. If you go in and do PCR on it, you know, you might find some antigens and breakdown products. And this in the old days used to be classified as one of the so-called tuberculids. But the way I like to think of it is it's a reaction to an underlying process that may or may not be an infectious disease. In some cases, it is infectious disease. This is exactly the same thing that you see with erythema nodosum leprosum. It looks very similar. It's basically nodular vasculitis caused by Hansen's disease. This is vasculitis with panniculitis caused by tuberculosis, but it can sometimes be caused by other conditions. Sometimes we see nodular vasculitis associated with connective tissue diseases, lupus, other things like that. So think of it as a reaction pattern. So something causes immune complex to be deposited here. You get vasculitis, and then you get a probably not purely secondary panniculitis, but you do get panniculitis associated with the vasculitis. And the reason I say not purely secondary is there are other situations where you get vascular involvement, which we'll, I don't know that we're going to talk about today, but we have talked about it with the vasculitis component, but things like migratory thrombophlebitis and subcutaneous polyarteritis nodosa, you see vasculitis there, but no panniculitis. So you can get vasculitis with total sparing of the lobules. So it doesn't, this isn't caused purely by ischemia. So you can get total thrombosis of a vein in the subcutaneous fat with very minimal inflammation of the fat. So there's a lot of residual secondary collateral circulation that supplies the fat. So if you get one of these large blood vessels that gets inflamed and thrombosed, you don't have to get any inflammation down here. So I really think that that's not just secondary, it's really part and parcel of the inflammatory condition. So immune complexes are deposited not only in blood vessels, but they're also deposited most likely in the fat as well. Okay, so this is probably the second most common panniculitis that we get biopsied, and I apologize for the tear on the slide there, but this is another example of a, it's really septal, it's mostly lobular again, mostly lobular panniculitis. And this is where you get the so-called membranous fat necrosis. You get this wispy, sort of crinkled, gossamer-like change to the subcutaneous fat here in the lobules, and then it becomes hyalinized and fibrosis over the course of time. And this is classic. Here you see that hyaline fat necrosis right over here, that beautiful, and actually you can stain this stuff with elastin, with BBG, and it's highlighted with that. That's a, I think some people call it an arabesque kind of appearance. I don't know why they call it that exactly, but it's a nice example of this sort of wispy gossamer change. And these are not lipocytes anymore. They're basically fat microcysts coupled with its fibroplasia. And then you get these stasis altered blood vessels here. This is lipodermatosclerosis, also called hypodermitis sclerodermiformis. It's called sclerodermiformis because it looks a lot like scleroderma because it's sclerotic, both clinically, and you also see some sclerosis of subcutaneous fat. And if you look at the dermis overlying this, You're going to see changes of stasis alteration all the time. So this is one of the bad manifestations of stasis change. So when you get stasis, lots of bad things can happen there. You can get stasis dermatitis, you can get stasis edema, you can get stasis associated lipidovasculitis, you can get this condition. So stasis, not good. It can lead to lots of bad things. And this is one of those. And this is probably the second most common inflammatory panniculitis that we see. So this is hyperdermitis, sclerodermiformis, and you get variable amounts of sclerosis. Sometimes it can look really sclerotic, like scleroderma. Sometimes you can get relatively limited amount of sclerosis here. I think the main sclerotic change here is down in the subcutaneous fat here. You see this area here. But when you see that wispy membranous fat necrosis, coupled with stasis alteration within usually extending somewhat deeply, like you see here, but especially in the overlying dermis of the papillary dermal area, basically you should be thinking this is the diagnosis, pretty much this until proven otherwise. And then if you see lots of stasis change that extends pretty deep, say down into like areas like you're getting into here, we often call that acroangiodermatitis of MALI, M-A-L-I. And that can simulate a vascular neoplasm. That can simulate Kaposi sarcoma, simulate a lot of things. So that's basically lipodermatosclerosis or hyperdermitis, sclerodermiformis, sclerosing panniculitis, whatever you want to call it. And that's associated with the classic sort of inverted champagne bottle appearance. Okay. Now this, if it doesn't fit anything, sometimes you have to sort of start thinking of other things. And here we've got panniculitis. Notice it's kind of taken by, gosh, it looks like they probably did maybe a punch, maybe took a couple of punches. Maybe they went in and tried to dissect out some of the fat. Clearly it's taken, it's fragmented here. And what's the pattern here? Well, we've got both lobular and we've got septals. We've got kind of a combination of both. And what kind of inflammation do we have in it? Well, we've got, you know, suppuration. We've got degeneration of fat here. We've got neutrophils. We've sort of got all sorts of things going on here. We've got these little small fat microcysts in this area. It doesn't really fit perfectly with any of the panniculitides. There's not really a classic vasculitis plus lobular involvement. There's not just pure septal involvement. It's a mixed pattern. So it doesn't fall any of the classic patterns of the panniculitides that we would think of, that we would describe and put in a textbook. So when it's something like that, you start thinking about the possibility that maybe it's factitial, or maybe it's been induced by trauma. And it's got all these little small holes in it. I would wonder about, and there's also some granulomatous inflammation here, I would wonder that maybe this is something that the person did factitially. And maybe they injected something into the area, you know, maybe make sure it's not silicone. So we would polarize something like this and make sure that it wasn't something that had been injected by the patient. If we didn't see anything there, maybe there's a history of trauma. And when patients get injured in a car accident, or maybe they've been hit hard with a baseball or a football game, they get hit with a helmet or something like that, and they get really super blunt trauma, the fat can sort of develop this sort of change. So this is also not a primary inflammatory panniculitis. It's basically when you damage your fat, it can actually be turned into a foreign body also. And then your body comes in and says, we got to get rid of all this damaged fat, gets suppurative granulomatous inflammation, gradually repairs everything. And then it ends up turning into kind of a depressed gully when it all heals. So this is an example of a traumatic fat necrosis in this case. This was not due to any primary panniculitis. This was a blunt trauma situation. And they were basically biopsying this, I think, to rule out maybe any kind of neoplasm or something, like maybe a, you know, sometimes people get injured and they develop fibrosarcomas and things like that at the sites of injury. So I think they were kind of concerned that it wasn't something like that. But the good news is it was just basically from a blunt trauma and wasn't due to any kind of an injury. So when it doesn't fit the classic pattern, think of factitial, or think about the possibility of some kind of traumatic insult. Okay, let's take a look at this one. And this is one that is a little different. So low power, and they did take a reasonably good biopsy. They basically got us down to the subcutaneous fat and noticed that it looks lobular. Okay, so there may be a little bit of septa here, might be slightly thickened, but certainly it's not massively thickened like we were seeing with erythematodosum early on. And we've got change that's confined to the lobules here almost purely. And notice that everything seems to be forming these little rims around the lipocytes. Now, people talk about this thing simulating lupus profundus. In my experience, it doesn't generally simulate that. I think that's overblown. I think it's not too terribly common for this entity to look like subcutaneous or to look like lupus profundus to me. I think it generally looks different. You generally don't get the same degree of hyaline fat degeneration. In lupus, you don't usually get this nice rimming around the individual lipocytes and the fat microcysts. And usually these are neutrophils, but also there are these lymphocytes that actually have acquired the ability to engulf other lymphocytes. And this is subcutaneous panniculitis-like T-cell lymphoma. Now there's the splitters have split this disease off into several different things now. There's the gamma delta type, which is a much more aggressive form of this process. There's the alpha beta type, which is a less aggressive form. And then I think they're even calling one, I think maybe the alpha beta type, maybe subcutaneous panniculitis-like T-cell proliferative disorder, because it doesn't really have the aggressive nature of the gamma delta type. It tends to look just like panniculitis. It's not really a classic inflammatory panniculitis, but when you see this pattern of rimming like this, and these cells actually home to the lipocytes, they actually have things on the cytoplasm of the cells that interact with the cytoplasm of the lipocytes or the membrane of the lipocytes. So that's actually like they've got an address there. They say, hey, we're going to the lipocytes here. And they go directly there, as opposed to other kind of cutaneous T-cell lymphomas that like the epidermis or like other parts of the skin, a little bit around the fat around the adnexal structures. But this is not really usually a epidermotropic T-cell lymphoma. A little bit of that here, but not very much. This is mostly an entity that likes the subcutaneous fat. So when you see this pattern, rimming with cells that some of them may be neutrophils, but others are actually lymphocytes that kind of have these breakdown products because they're actually lymphocytes that get destroyed and they get engulfed by other T lymphocytes that acquire the ability to engulf these little particles of the lymphocytes. You should be thinking about one of the variants of subcutaneous panniculitis like T-cell lymphomas. In my experience, the gamma delta type tends to be a much denser infiltrate with much more fat degeneration. The alpha beta type looks a bit more like this, but generally you need to do immunostaining and clinical correlation to define those. The gamma delta subtype is a much more aggressive type. And if there is involvement of the epidermis where it looks almost like MF overlying, that tends to favor the gamma delta type. And that's actually usually CD8 positive CTCL if it's present. There's a little bit of that here. I think if I saw this blind and somebody sent it in to me as rule out MF, I actually would be concerned about that here. So this might be the gamma delta variant in this case, I'm not sure. But anyway, this is what you see in this subcutaneous panniculitis-like T-cell lymphoma. To me, generally not that difficult to tell this from lupus profundus. Usually not the degree of fat degeneration, usually not as many plasma cells as we see in that condition. Okay, sometimes we get something, again, I'm making it sound like panniculitis is always easy, and you know, it's usually reasonably easy to diagnose, but sometimes we get something like this that's just basically a degenerated, diffuse fat that's just inflamed, mummified, destroyed. It's got lots of vasculitis with vasculopathy here. I don't know what this is exactly. We weren't sure what this is. But I'll tell you what, I'd be very concerned when I saw something like this about a couple of different things. Number one, sometimes deep fungal infections actually not the classic deep fungal infections like Sporo and those sort of things, but Mucor, the things like rhizopus, mucorales, those kind of things, the mucormycosis, those things can get into the fat, cause massive fat degeneration without much inflammation, often in an immunocompromised patient. And if you saw something like this, that's to me would be the number one thing that you would need to rule out. So you always look when you see fat degeneration that's streamed like this without much inflammation, you should be thinking an immune compromised situation and make sure that the patient doesn't have something like that. Notice all these blood vessels are thrombosed. This is a very bad situation. This could also be associated with some kind of systemic thrombotic vasculopathy that's associated with fat degeneration. So we weren't sure about this case. We signed it out as lobular panniculitis with vasculopathy, and we did stain it. We did make sure it wasn't mucor or anything like that. I don't know if they actually were able to demonstrate in this case what the patient had, but when you see something like this, this doesn't fit the classic pattern of any of the normal panniculitis. This isn't lupus. It's not erythema nodulatum. It does have all this thrombosis. It does have some inflammation over here, but it's certainly not densely inflamed here. So when you see something like this, think about the possibility of an infection like mucor, something like that. So remember, degenerated fat, not much inflammation, thrombotic blood vessels, make sure you're not dealing with a serious infectious disease or other kind of serious systemic vasculopathic type process. Okay. All right, another example. This is another example. We've already seen one of these today. So this is just another more prominent example that's more prototypical. So notice we've got a lobular, mostly panniculitis with some septal involvement, the septa are thickened as well. We've got all these holes in here, and these are fat microcysts. Okay, this is analogous to somebody that's got emphysema in the lung, where the alveoli rupture into little blebs there. So these are not lymphocytes anymore. These are analogous to air sacs that have dumped in to form these emphyseminous blebs in your lung. So fat microcysts. And then we look down here, we've got all this hyaline sclerosis here, and we've got the change over here. What's this change over here called? This is the membranous fat necrosis again. So this is another example of sclerosing panniculitis. This is with much more sclerosis than the last one we saw. So this is going to be much more bound down. This is that classic membranous fat necrosis. Beautiful example of that here, that wispy gossamer type, looks like spider webs here. Beautiful example of that. And then we're going to look at the overlying dermis. You're going to see massive amounts of overlying stasis change here. Look at these stasis blood vessels go all the way down into the subcutaneous fat here. Some of these are equine sweat glands, but a lot of these are blood vessels as well over here. And then we've got at the part of the dermis up here, we're going to see these stasis altered blood vessels again. So again, this is a nice example of sclerosing panniculitis, another name for hyperdermatous sclerodermiformis for lipodermatosclerosis. So this one, just another example that just shows a much more florid example of this. Okay, let's look at case number 10 over here. Go back to this one. Okay. Beautiful biopsies. So we love it when we get a nice deep biopsy of panniculitis. And let's turn this around. Okay, there we go. So pattern, we've got lobular, mostly panniculitis. Okay, so lobular, go to higher magnification. What kind of cells are we going to see? We can see mostly lymphocytes here. And we've also got some histiocytes with some fat degeneration. Okay, so what's this diagnosis in this case? Is there any vasculitis here? Not really. Blood vessel is spared. So this is hitting, and are these rimming the lymphocytes like we saw with the subcutaneous panniculitis like lymphoma? No, it's just kind of a diffuse pattern of lymphocytes and histiocytes. And it's just involving almost purely the subcutaneous fat and the fat that's around the adnexal structures. Notice the epidermis is not involved at all. And this is an interesting panniculitis. It's a relatively rare form of panniculitis that's associated in children, pediatric situations. And this is known as lobular lipoatrophic panniculitis. We're not sure what this disease is. It seems to be a separate entity itself. Some people have thought, well, maybe it's a variant of lupus profundus. I don't think it is. I think it's a different entity. Some people think it may be related to alpha beta subcutaneous panniculitis like T-cell lymphoma. I think it's probably closer to that than lupus, but it's also possibly its own separate entity. These kids get these areas that you biopsy and they show all this inflammation and then it goes away and they get these big atrophic areas, these big gullies, and they can get large areas of involvement. And this is sort of like lupus in a way. It can involve the upper part of the body, can involve the face. Most of the time it involves the trunk and legs, but it can involve other parts of the body. But this is just another example of showing the pattern of diffuse lobular panniculitis. And here it's got lymphocytes and histiocytes, and it doesn't heal with that sclerotic pattern like we see with lupus. So it's probably not truly LE. It's probably its own separate entity. And there are a few other childhood types of panniculitis. Blouse syndrome is another one where they get a form of panniculitis. It can be lobular and whatnot. So this may be somehow related to that. It may be in the family of the auto-inflammatory conditions associated with panniculitis, but it's just showing another example of a lobular, mostly panniculitis, a relatively rare entity. But this does happen and it's seen sometimes in children. So just make sure you know about it. But the main thing is just to show the beautiful example of this lobular, mostly pattern with these lymphocytes and these histiocytes here. Whenever you get degeneration of the fat, you're almost always going to get some foamy histiocytes because there's macrophages come in, engulfs the lipid, and then they get foamy. So this isn't like a, you see with a xanthoma, for example. It's more just a secondary foamy histiocytes come in because of the lipid. Okay, the last one we're going to look at, again, we've got a mixed pattern. We've got septal involvement, we've got lobular involvement, and let's go to higher magnification, and we've got suppuration, and we've got granulomatous inflammation. So mixed pattern, suppurative granulomatous involvement, got no vasculitis, at least in these specimens. So if we just saw this without any information, we might say, well, you know, we want to make sure we're not missing nodular vasculitis, but they just didn't get the blood vessels, so that would be important. But in the context of the history, this was a patient that was ill. And this was thought to possibly be an infection in this case. And I believe this case was ultimately found to be associated with some type of an infectious disease in this situation. Might have even been an AFB infection. It might have been possibly something like histo or whatever. But you can get, when you get suppurative granulomatous panniculitis, without the classic pattern of erythema nodosum, without the classic pattern of nodular vasculitis, you should always be thinking about the possibility of an infection. Could be pyogenic infection, like an abscess, could be a deep fungal infection, sporo, things like that. Usually, if you get panniculitis, there's gonna be overlying infectious changes in the dermis, but not always. Sometimes these things can be deep. And we see things like, some of the other unusual infections can sometimes give you panniculitis, mostly like actinomyces sometimes can give it to you, nocardia. Some of those things can sometimes be associated with a suppurative granulomatous panniculitis. It's really due mostly to an infection. So if it doesn't fit, always think about other things that can cause it. Think about factitial, think about trauma, think about infection. Pretty much in a case like this, even in a nodular vasculitis case, we would generally do PAS fight stains, maybe cultures, recommend those to make sure we're not missing an infection, something that's treatable. And then even if it's not, about 40 to 50% of the time, it can be truly infectious with negative special stains. So you wanna make sure that you consider cultures or possibly PCR or something like that if there's really a strong index of suspicion of an infection. And don't forget about doing some of the other relatively inexpensive test. Quantiferon gold, for example, in a situation of a an atypical mycobacterial infection, even though that's not really TB, sometimes can be positive. Skin testing sometimes be positive because there's some cross reactivity of the inflammation there. So just remember those other things that can be used to help make a diagnosis. So that's panniculitis. I think we covered most everything today. There's still a few things that we didn't cover, but that gets the vast majority of them, the most of the patterns that we talk about. So hopefully you'll be able to use these criteria to help you make a diagnosis. It's really usually not that hard compared to some of the other diseases that we have to deal with. So thank you for listening. And we will see you next week, or I think we remember the topic next week, but we'll deal with another series of known cases and take you through that and hopefully make you better at diagnosing some of these relatively unusual entities. Take care.